Oh, you're serving this morning too.
I know.
Oh, yeah.
Morning, everybody. It's good to see you today. It's 10:30 start time, so come on in and get a seat. Let's worship the Lord this morning, and to begin our service, I wanted to read from Gospel of Matthew. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28 through 30. Jesus talking to his disciples, he has these words to say. Come to me, all who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you'll find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Let's all stand and open up in prayer this morning. Lord, this morning we come to you. We come to you, Lord, to worship you. We know that you are the God of comfort, grace, mercy, love, goodness. So we come into your presence this morning. We come into your presence, Lord, some of us carrying some burdens from this week. And we just lay them down at your feet, Lord, today. May we be able to just simply focus on you, your greatness, your goodness, who you are, Lord, and may our songs, our thoughts, our prayers, everything we do, Lord, right now, be focused on you. And Lord, may you get all the glory in this worship service this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
One day when heaven was filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came for to be born a virgin, dwelt among men by a temple of the sea. Who became flesh and light shined among us, glory revealed. Living he loved me, dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away. Rising he justified, freely forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day. Despised and rejected, bearing our sins, my Redeemer is here. His adoration stretched out on the tree, and took the nails to me. Living he loved me, dying he saved me. Buried he carried my sins far away, rising he justified. Freely forever, one day he's coming, a glorious day, a glorious day. Only the grave could conceal him no longer. One day his stone broke for the door. Rise if you justify, free me forever. One day he's coming, a glorious day, a glorious day.
This is amazing grace.
cross. Even the tender night, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I say for all that you've done for me. Praise the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Thank you. Well, I know we're having our Thanksgiving lunch today, so like with the families next week. And somebody at work, I was telling them what I'm doing today, we're at Thanksgiving lunch, and they're like, why is it Thanksgiving? And I said, but isn't every day Thanksgiving? No, should it be? This time of year we talk about Christmas, and everybody gets the giving spirit, the Christmas spirit. Shouldn't it be that way every day? So, today, let's pretend it's Thanksgiving Day. Let's have that spirit, because all we're doing is giving thanks for the things that have been given to us, and that we can't get a lot of things on our own. And the only way that we are here to be able to do that is through the one who gave everything for us, and that's Jesus on the cross. So right now, we're going to come to a time of communion, and we'll have a communion song and a communion thought.
have to, in our everyday lives, in our hectic schedules, our work schedules, our families, and oftentimes during the week we forget Jesus died on the cross for us. We just take it for granted. And we need to take time, not only right now, but during our prayer life every day, to thank God for sending His only begotten Son. The sacrifice that Jesus made for us. He's our hope. He's the peace, like a river in our life. In Matthew 26:29, Jesus says, I tell you, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now until today, when I break it anew with you in my Father's kingdom. During communion, we honor Jesus. This is our time we take each day, on each Sunday, along with what we need to take each day in our prayer life. So thank God for that's our salvation. Without Jesus, we're lost. So, and it's for our prayer to take time to anybody that does not acknowledge that Jesus lived. Even the demons tremble at His name. They know He lived. Philippians 2:9-11 says, therefore God exalted Him to the highest place and gave Him a name that is above every name. That that name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Of those in heaven, and those on earth, and of those under the earth. Like Chuck talked about that a couple of weeks ago. That Jesus, after what we thought about it done during the time that He was dead on the earth, when He was preaching. That every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, the glory of God, the Father. All right, while we celebrate might be quite simpler and different than when Christmas and other things we do, this is the most important thing we do. We do it every Sunday. And it's like the hymn, the old hymn says, redeemed, how I love the claim, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy, His child, wherever I am. Come on. Father, we're thankful for You love us so much as You sent Your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. For He died on the cross to remission our sins. For the hope that You give us in Jesus. Father, we're thankful for Your grace. We're thankful for the privilege that You give us to be brothers and sisters in Christ, be a part of Your church. Please help us to always hold this close in our hearts, not only at this time, but every day of our life as we go through this life. That we are brothers and sisters in Christ with Jesus. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you.
We thank you so much, and we ask that we give that gift so that you send your church, put your word out. And we ask it in the name of Jesus Christ.
Go to God in prayer. Lord, once again, Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the privilege to gather together with brothers and sisters in Christ to worship you this morning in this place, and just to magnify your name, to think our thoughts on you this morning, Lord, and just in our humble way, strive to bless your name. Lord, we pray this morning for those that you know that are struggling with sickness and disease and pain and suffering, Lord. We pray that you might touch their bodies with healing and just restore them. Give them health and wellness that they need right now in their bodies. Pray for those that are grieving the loss of loved ones. Pray that you might feel that loss that they're feeling this morning with your peace. Pray for our nation, for our country, for our leaders, that they would make wise and godly decisions. We pray for the servicemen and servicewomen serving around the world. There are several that we know that we have listed, Lord, in our bulletin. Pray that you'd keep them safe and bring them home soon. Lord, I pray that you would help us as your local church here in this community to continue to be a bright light for you of your truth, your gospel, the word, and the life that is in you, Lord. Right now, as we come to a time of opening up our Bibles, Lord, to study your word, I pray that you might just teach us what you have for us today, and just may we have open ears and open hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you open up your Bibles with me and turn to 1 Peter chapter 4. I'd like to read verses, 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 through 11 this morning. And we're going to continue to make our way through this letter. You know, when the Lord Jesus came to earth and he was calling disciples to come and follow him, you can't help but read the Gospels, and especially when you get towards the end of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke in particular, because we see a chronology when you read through those Gospel accounts. When you get towards the end and Jesus is like almost one-on-one with the 12 disciples who were going to become the apostles of the church, when you get to that time, he over and over again will say to them what it will cost to be a follower of Christ. He'll use those words, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. Matter of fact, Matthew, Mark, and Luke both quote those words exactly as Jesus said, and they knew the significance of that meaning, that to follow Jesus was going to cost you something. You are going to have to sacrifice yourself. You are going to have to take up your cross. In that day and time, that meant you got to be willing to die for this cause that you're going to be involved in. You got to be willing to follow in my footsteps. They knew the cost of what that would be. Matter of fact, those disciples that he is sharing that with would be the ones who would lay down their life for the gospel and die, all die a martyr's death, except for John being left on the island. But they would all die for their faith. It costs something to follow Jesus. When you come to a decision in your life, when you want to deal with your sin and trust Jesus as your Savior, you realize there is a cost that you're going to pay. But Jesus also told his disciples and us what I read you this morning at the beginning of our worship service. It is a gracious call. He says, "Come to me, all ye who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke," and he meant serving me, "upon you. Take my yoke upon you, because my yoke is easy and my burden is light." So it's as if Jesus is telling his disciples and even us that following him is a paradox. It costs something, but it's also something that brings about a great blessing in your life. The cost and the blessing. Sometimes I believe when Peter writes these words that I'm going to read to you, I think what was in his mind was they knew the cost, but as they're struggling along in suffering for the cause of Christ and being persecuted simply because they're Christians, the reason he emphasizes it over and over in the letter is evidently some of them were falling away. Some of them were giving up. Some of them were cashing it in. Some of them were saying, "The cost is too great. I can't lay down my life. I can't do that." And so to me, I believe he's reminding them about the basics of what Jesus called them to do. It is a cost, but yet he promises that the yoke is easy and the burden is light. He's going to call you to a great cost, but he's going to give you everything you need in your life to make it through that, whatever it is you're going to face in life. And the way that he does that, as we make our way through this letter, chapter 4, he says, the way you make your way through that, the first paragraph talked about remembering and realizing who you are in Christ, your identity with Christ. Now when we get to this verse, verse 7, he immediately opens up with a reality. It's not only remembering your identity in Christ and who you are in Christ, but it is the reward. It is focusing on who is going to welcome you into the kingdom, Jesus Christ. And he talks about focusing on the second coming of Christ, when Jesus comes back. Keep your focus on who you are and who's coming for you. Who you are and who's coming for you. Jesus is coming. Keep your eyes focused on that. Let me read the verses to you. Will you stand with me as I read the Bible to you? And then before you sit down, I want to encourage you with at least one thing you can take home from today's message. First Peter chapter 4. Starting with verse 7, he says, "The end of all things is near. Therefore, be of sound judgment and sober spirit for the purpose of prayer. Above all, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaint. As each one has received a special gift, employ it in serving one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. Whoever speaks is to do so as the one who is speaking the utterances of God. Whoever serves is to do so as one who is serving by the strength which God supplies, so that in all things God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to whom belongs the glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Before you sit down, will you share this one thought with your neighbor? One thing to take home from today. And it's simply this. It's a question. And the question is, what is your purpose? What is your purpose? Thank you. You can be seated. What is your purpose? What is your purpose? What is your purpose in this life as a follower of Christ? You've counted the cost. You know what the cost is. You know that Christ provides comfort in the journey as you're making. But what is my purpose? Well, as I was looking at these verses, you notice that first statement, he says, the end of all things is near. The word end that he uses right there in that text means consummation or fulfillment. So the consummation and the fulfillment. And then the second thing he says is near. The word near means it's approaching. And so he's talking about the consummation of all things is near. When that phrase is used other places in our New Testament, it refers to the second coming of Jesus Christ. That Jesus Christ is coming again. And then the New Testament will constantly exhort us and encourage us that because Jesus Christ is coming again, the most important thing that you can do in your life is be ready for the coming of the Lord. Be ready for Christ's coming. So in this passage, why does Peter use that phrase that signifies the coming of the Lord? Because I believe he's going to challenge them with, in these few verses, the basics of the Christian life. And he wanted to go back to the basics because he knew they were tempted to cave into the pressure and not carry on in their faith because it's just too much. They couldn't quite see that the yoke was easy and the burden was light. And so he goes back and says, remember these basics for your life. The basics of the Christian life. There's three of them. The first one, if you want to follow along on the outline, the first one is the word godliness. It's godliness. The key, godliness simply means you're going to hate sin and love righteousness. The key to handling trials and temptations is developing a system in your life of daily spiritual disciplines, which includes cultivating the necessary spiritual disciplines that produce growing faith and courage. That's why I believe the very next thing he says in that verse, after he says the end of all things is near, therefore, so this is the point he wants to make, be of sound judgment and sober spirit. So be of sound judgment and sober spirit. To be of sound judgment literally means to be in one's right mind, to be under control and not carried away by an errant view of oneself. It means to guard the mind, Proverbs 4:23. It means that our minds must be clearly fixed on spiritual priorities and righteous living. It means that our sound mind and sound thinking. It was the words that God gave to Joshua in Joshua 1, verse 8, where he says, the key to being successful and prosperous in your life, in anything and everything that you face in life, God told Joshua, was my word. Stay in my word, in the law of God. If you stay in the law of God, you can handle anything in life. And if you live your life this way, you will be successful. And not only successful, but you will be prosperous, he says, in the word. Jesus would say this when he's talking about when you're anxious or worried about stuff in your life. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, he would say, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And all these things, this stuff that you're worrying about, will be taken care of. But remember to seek me first. Colossians chapter 3, verse 2, the Apostle Paul would say this about being sound in mind. He would say this, set your mind on things above, not on the things of this earth. Keep your mind in the right place. Be of sound judgment. The devil wants to distract us from what God wants to do. The devil wants to deflect us from doing what God wants to do, what wants us to do. The devil ultimately wants to destroy us. Our minds are to continually to be subjected to Jesus Christ. In 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, Paul says, if we want to break down strongholds of what Satan wants to do in our life to get us off the track and off of godliness and off of holiness, then what he says we have to do is take every thought captive and make it obedient to the Lord Jesus Christ. Take everything. Use sound judgment, a clear mind on what God wants to do. 2 Timothy 3, 15 and 16 says, the way that you and I are going to grow in godliness is dependent upon our relationship with the Scripture, because he says all Scripture is inspired by God and profitable for teaching, reproof, correction, and training in righteousness, that the man of God or woman of God can be thoroughly equipped for every good work. We will be equipped for every good work when we soundly focus on God's Word in our life. So he challenges them. He wants to motivate them. When you want to give up, when the stuff gets too hard to do in life, when the pain is too intense, when the suffering is too much, remember to grow in your knowledge of God's Word. Focus on God's Word and God's truth. Then he says to be sober in spirit. That means to be spiritually alert to what's going on. We read our Bibles, we study our Word, so that we can be spiritually alert to what is going on around us. We can take God's Word and apply it to our life. Jude doesn't have chapters. Jude has verses. Jude, verse 20. This is what Jude meant by praying in the Spirit. Praying in the Spirit is when you have the Word of God and you're spiritually alert to what's going on, and you're taking the Word of God and you're applying it to your life. I am describing to you what godliness is. Paul challenged Timothy. He says, discipline yourself for the purpose of godliness. You want to grow in godliness, then discipline yourself in the spiritual disciplines. Devote yourself to the study of God's Word, to reading it, to studying it, to knowing it, not just reading it so you can fill your mind with knowledge, but apply it to your life. Share it with those around you. Apply it to your situations and your circumstances in life. Godliness means that we are going to be pleasing to God. He says in our verse that this sound judgment and sober spirit is for the purpose of prayer. Now in our English Bible it says prayer. In the original text it's a plural, prayers. We couldn't say for the purpose of prayers because it sounds weird, right? He's talking about your prayer life, your communing with God. He's saying that you do these things for your relationship with God. That's why I got this word godliness that he's talking about. So he's challenging us to live in godliness. So you're going to have a sound judgment, sober spirit, for the purpose of prayer, for your purpose of communing with God. So it says, if in your daily time, your quiet time with God, your devotion, whatever you call it, instead of praying first, we need to open up our Bibles and read the Word. And then our prayers should reflect what we're reading in the Scriptures so that they will be godly prayers. So now how do we practice this in our life? I put on your outline, there's a question to ask. And it's the question of, what is your purpose? What is your purpose? Let me give you the short answer. Your purpose as a follower of Christ is to grow in godliness. So now how do we grow in godliness? Let me illustrate it this way. Because godliness is more than just doing what Jesus would do. Godliness is more than just going through the motions. It reminds me of the the little boy that wants to be the baseball hero. He sees his hero on TV, and he wants to be that baseball hero. And so he goes out in the yard, and he stands in a batter's box, and he holds his bat exactly like his hero does. I remember seeing this in Little League Baseball. It was so funny. A lot of times it was just really cute. They would wave the bat like so-and-so, or stand a certain way, or stand this way, or whatever. They're imitating their hero. They want to do it just like he does it. Or the little kid that wants to be a doctor because somebody in the family is a doctor, and they think that's really cool. And so they got the pretend stethoscope in the pretend shot, and they go around the house pretending to be a doctor. Or the child that goes to the concert and hears someone playing an instrument beautifully and says, you know what, I want to learn how to play that. And you get them that instrument, and they go home and they try to play that instrument, and when they're playing it, to them it sounds just like that, but to you it's like, holy cow, shut the door. Turn it down a notch. They play at it. They play at it because they see their famous baseball player in the World Series. The game is on the line. The runners are in scoring position. He steps into the batter's box, and he hits the ball, and he gets the base hit right up the middle and brings home the winning run. And the game is won because, it looks like, because of the hero hitting the ball right up the middle. And he thinks that it's just because he's standing in the yard, and if he can stand just like that, then he can do the same thing. And yet he doesn't realize the years, the hours, standing in the batting cage, hitting thousands of pitches from his dad, or from the pitching machine, or from the batting tee, and perfecting that swing after years of doing that. Or the doctor, you go to the emergency room with the emergency that you have, whatever it is. The doctor comes in and he knows exactly what to do. And he knows that because of years of studying, years of being an intern, learning from somebody else. And he knows exactly what to do, and he saves that life because of all that he's done. The musician at the concert that we go to hear, and they play it perfect. Every pitch, every note is just right, and they hit the note just right. It's the hours of practice. It's the lessons that they took. It's all the painstaking stuff that led up to that point. So here's my point. That's the Christian life. Godliness is not just something you do one time, and you do that one time, and then all of a sudden you're ready for the stuff of life. Godliness is when the bottom drops out and you're in desperate need of God. Godliness shows up. That times that you spent in the Word, the times that you commune with God, the times that you spent in prayer, the verses that come to your mind because you've been reading the Bible over and over again, that stuff happens. It doesn't just happen. That to me is what Peter's talking about. He's drawing them to their real purpose. Your purpose of how you're going to make it through this life is godliness. Day by day, habits, routines that you get into of godliness, holiness, and worshiping, studying, knowing the Word of God and the truth that God wants to reveal to you. So he says to me, first of all, he says, I need you to grow. You need to remember to grow in godliness. The second thing he brings up is this word. The second thing he wants them to grow in is love. In verse 8 and verse 9, he talks about love. He says, I want you to grow in love. And he classifies it. Do you see it in your Bible? He says, love for one another. He's not talking about a general love for everybody around you or a love for the world. He's talking about your love for one another. And here he is talking to these Christians struggling through the persecution that they're going through in their life. And he says, I want you to remember that you need to grow in your love. He says to be fervent about your love. That word fervent means that you're going to stretch, you're going to strain. It's the picture of the runner who's getting, who's running in the race, and he's straining every muscle in his body to get to that finish line. That's the picture. He says, secondly, also he says that to keep fervent in your love for one another, because it covers sin. It covers sin. It is self-evident that genuine love inherently tends to forgive the offenses of others. Love covers a multitude of sins. He can mean that God's love covers sins. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. God covers sins. He can mean by that that believers who lovingly overlook each other's transgressions cover sin. It's sin. It's dealing with sin. It's helping others deal with sin in a loving way. The word He used for love is agape love. It's 1 Corinthians 13, where Paul says, love is patient, love is kind. And He defines for us what God-like love is. It's that kind of love. It's a love of our will and our volition. He says in verse 9, be hospitable. He's reminding them to be hospitable. The word literally means to love strangers. He says, because believers still sin, Romans 7, Paul talks about that. The only thing that will preserve the church's unity is love that forgives and reaches out in kindness even to strangers. Love is the foundational to reaching an unsaved world. And this is how it reaches an unsaved world. John 13:35, where Jesus says, you'll know My disciples by their love one for another. He's not talking about how we love the world. He's talking about how we love one another. How we love in the church is how we evangelize the world. Loving and modeling the love of Christ for one another, forgiving each other, blessing each other, encouraging each other, helping each other. That model is that how we reach the world. They see that there's something different about those people they love. I put a question on your outline, and it's simply this: what is your passion? What's your passion? So we're not just talking about purpose of godliness. We're talking about passion. Passion, I read one time years ago, defined what passion is. It's what you cry about. It's what you sing about. It's what you dream about. What do you cry about? What stirs your emotions? What do you dream about? What do you constantly think about in your life? What do you sing about? What brings about the greatest joy in your life? Peter is challenging these Christians with, listen, this is what your passion should be. Love for God and love for one another. Now go back to the little boy pretending to be the hero in the baseball. Go back to the thought about the little child running around the house pretending to be a doctor. Go back to that time when your children are trying to play that instrument for the 100,000th time. You're having to listen to the same song painstakingly. Love can't be pretended. You can't pretend to love someone. You can't say, well, I don't love you, but I like you. Christians, we can't say that. That's not God-like love. God doesn't say that to us. Well, I like him. He's got a few stuff that I don't really like about him, but I still love him. Oh, he says love. He says you can't, it's not pretending. That kind of love comes from a godly walk with God, where you're growing closer and closer to Him so that you can forgive offenses, you can love the unlovable, you can love even when people hurt you. So are you growing in your passion for Christ and others? The last one that I want to encourage you with this morning is found in verse 10 and 11. The third one is where we serve, serving one another. It's not just godliness, which has to do with purpose. It's not just love, which has to do with what we're passionate about, but it's about our service. Our service, he says, he challenges us to be a good steward of the gifts that God has given you. And specifically, he says, the special gift that God has given you. The word that he used for special gift is where we get the word spiritual gift. It's talked about in 1 Corinthians 12 and Romans chapter 12. And there's a lot there. There's a lot in this, the one statement when I say spiritual gifts. There's a whole sermon. There's a whole sermon series that I could sit here and talk to you for hours about. But I will not be tempted. He says, don't forget to serve. Don't pretend to love. Don't pretend to serve one another. Employ the gift that God's given you. A spiritual gift is a divine enablement from God. It's something that the Holy Spirit gives you. It's not something that you ask or request. You can't even pray to get it. He gives it to you. And then it's used, the gift is to be used in the body, in the church, to build up the church, to edify the church, to bless the church. And so when you're here and you're engaging in your spiritual gift that God's given you, now, how do you know what your spiritual gift is? If it's your father and he gives you a gift, it's not something that you're not going to know or figure out what it is. He doesn't give it. It's not a surprise gift. It takes you all of your life to eventually unwrap. It's a gift that he gives you that you know. It's something that you desire to do for God. It's something that people look at your life and say, you're gifted at that. It's something that people look at your life and you can see fruit from that in your life when you serve in that way. Now the Bible gives us a list in 1 Corinthians 12 and Romans 12 of spiritual gifts. But right here in our text, he says there's variations of those gifts. And in Romans chapter 12, verse 3, Paul says that God not only gives you a gift, but he gives you the faith to enact and believe and use that gift. So they're not just set to one way. They're various ways that we use our giftedness to minister to the body of Christ. So Peter's point right here is why he doesn't go into great detail. He just says, listen, be a good steward of the gift. The spiritual gift that God has given to you, use it in the church. Don't be tempted to give up. Don't be tempted to quit. Even though the suffering, even though the mistreatment, even though the misunderstanding, you're just serving Christ. This is the second wave of persecution that's hitting the church. This is a persecution that simply because you're a Christian, you're being arrested, put in jail. And some are even being killed simply because they're Christians. So even in this, even when you're facing these things, even when you're counting the cost constantly, even daily in your life about serving the Lord, remember, keep on serving. You keep on showing up at church. Because when you're not at church, then your gift is not used. And when you're not at church and your gift is not used, there's a hole and there's an empty spot in the church. That's why it's important for you and I to be here every Lord's Day, to be involved, to hear about each other's life, to be involved in ministering and touching people's lives, so that we're not just pretending to be Christians. But our Christianity is flowing from that godliness, from that walk that we have, that daily walk with God. And whatever God is revealing to me, then that's what I'm going to purpose and plan in my life for God. He says, if you have a speaking gift or a serving gift, he talks about that. He breaks them into two categories. Some of you are going to be speaking. You're going to be preaching and teaching or words of wisdom. Some of you are going to have that gift. Some of you are going to be serving, helps and administration. You're going to have whatever the gift is. When he talks about speaking gift, he says, speak as if the utterance is from God. The word utterance means oracles. He's talking about whatever you say. Don't let it just be human thought and human wisdom, but let it be the words of God. So when you preach, give people the word of God. When you teach, give people the word of God, because that's the power to transform and to change your life. It's the power to save. It's the power to live the godly life. And when you serve, he says in our verse, don't do it just in your own human strength, but he says, do it in the strength of the Lord. And he says, so that, the last phrase of the last, so that God will get the glory. Everything you do, everything I do, you do in your life, our purpose is to bring glory to God through our godliness, through our love, and through our service. So the question for point number three is simply this. What do you possess? What do you possess? What are your gifts? What do you have? And are you growing in what you're giving to God? Are you growing in what you're, how you're purposing in your life to minister and use what God has given you for His glory and for His kingdom? So he's saying to the church, don't pretend to be a Christian. Pretend Christians, they come and they go. They come for a while and then they go. They're pretending to be Christians. They think that Christianity is just going to church or just reading your Bible or it's going through the motions or volunteering for this or serving in this, that that's all Christianity is. It's not Christianity. And when life falls apart, that won't carry you through. What will carry you through is your relationship and the godliness that God's bringing about is coming from within you in your life. And how the Holy Spirit is able to communicate to you the Word of God because you've been reading it and soaking it up and you're living it out in your life. That's the kind of life He's trying to motivate them to. I'm trying to motivate you to it. What's your purpose? The purpose is to grow in godliness. It's to grow in your love, in your service, in ministry to the Lord and to one another. Let's pray. Lord, I just thank you for your word. I thank you, Lord, for the truth this morning that you have for us. Here we are, Lord, living in a time awaiting your return, Lord. And we know from your word that you can come back at any time, at any point, in any moment. May we, Lord, be ready for your coming. If there's someone here today, Lord, that has never repented of their sin, realize that they're a sinner and they're hopelessly lost without you, Lord, may you put it on their minds to turn from their sin and trust you alone for salvation. May they have enough courage to step forward this morning and boldly confess you now as Lord and Savior of their life by being baptized into you even today, Lord. May they be willing to do that. Lord, if someone here today has been convicted about pretending to be a Christian, may your Holy Spirit just speak to their hearts, speak to their life, their mind, about the life that you have for them. May they come to you, all who are weary, and know that your yoke is easy and your burden is light. In Jesus' name, amen. Will you stand with me and we'll sing a decision song? If you want to make a decision for Christ, I encourage you to do that today.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. So I have decided to follow Jesus. Now turn me back. Turning back. the cross before me, no turning back, no turning back.
We're glad that you're here to worship the Lord with us today, and if you're visiting, we're glad that you came. I hope you'll come back again. We're going to have a Thanksgiving meal right now after our service, so things have been prepared. I'm going to say a blessing over the food. You're going to be dismissed, and you can just kind of go out these doors and walk down the hall, come back in this, in here, and sit down and take a seat. We'd love for you to stay. If you're visiting, we always have plenty of food, so please feel welcome to stay and eat lunch with us. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for this day. We just thank you for many blessings that you pour out upon us, Lord. We're so thankful and grateful. Lord, this morning, we've gathered together to worship you, to praise you, to glorify you, Lord. Now, Lord, we want to continue our fellowship with one another. We thank you, Lord, for a meal that's been prepared, for the hands that prepared it, and pray, Lord, that it will be blessed and nourished for use in serving you in your kingdom. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.